Blackstone Audio presents A Patriot's History of the United States, From Columbus's Great Discovery to the War on Terror, by Larry Schweikart and Michael Allen. Acknowledgements. Larry Schweikart would like to thank Jesse McIntyre and Aaron Sorrentino for their contribution to Charts and Graphs, and Julia Couples, Brian Rogan, Andrew Guff, and Danielle Elam for research. Cynthia King performed heroic typing work on crash schedules. The University of Dayton, particularly Dean Paul Mormon, supported this work through a number of grants. Michael Allen would like to thank Bill Richardson, Director of Interdisciplinary Arts and Sciences at the University of Washington, Tacoma, for his friendship and collegial support for over a decade. We would both like to thank Mark Smith, David Beto, Brad Berzer, Robert Loewenberg, Jeff Hanneken, David Horowitz, Jonathan Bean, Constantine Guzman, Burton Folsom Jr., Julius Amon, and Michael Etchison for comments on the manuscript. Ed Knappman and the staff at New England Publishing Associates believed in this book from the beginning and have our undying gratitude. Our special thanks to Bernadette Malone, whose efforts made this possible, to Megan Casey for her sharp eye, and to David Fredoso for his ruthless but much-needed pen. Introduction. Is America's past a tale of racism, sexism, and bigotry? Is it the story of the conquest and rape of a continent? Is U.S. history the story of white slave owners who perverted the electoral process for their own interests? Did America start with Columbus's killing all the Indians, leap to Jim Crow laws and Rockefeller crushing the workers, then finally save itself with Franklin Roosevelt's New Deal? The answers, of course, are no, 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 and no. One might never know this, however, by looking at almost any mainstream U.S. history textbook. Having taught American history in one form or another for close to 60 years between us, we are aware that, unfortunately, many students are berated with tales of the founders as self-interested politicians and slaveholders, of the icons of American industry as robber baron oppressors, and of every American foreign policy initiative as imperialistic and insensitive. At least Howard Zinn's A People's History of the United States honestly represents its Marxist biases in the title. What is most amazing and refreshing is that the past usually speaks for itself. The evidence is there for telling the great story of the American past honestly, with flaws, absolutely, with shortcomings, most definitely. But we think that an honest evaluation of the history of the United States must begin and end with the recognition that, compared to any other nation, America's past is a bright and shining light. America was and is the city on the hill, the fountain of hope, the beacon of liberty. We utterly reject my country, right or wrong. What scholar wouldn't? But in the last 30 years, academics have taken an equally destructive approach. My country always wrong. We reject that, too. Instead, we remain convinced that if the story of America's past is told fairly, the result cannot be anything but a deepened patriotism, a sense of awe at the obstacles overcome, the passion invested, the blood and tears spilled, and the nation that was built. An honest review of America's past would note, among other observations, that the same founders who owned slaves instituted numerous ways, political and intellectual, to ensure that slavery could not survive. That the concerns over not just property rights, but all rights, so infused American life that laws often followed the practices of the common folk rather than dictated to them. That even when the United States used her military power for dubious reasons, the ultimate result was to liberate people and bring a higher standard of living than before. That time and again America's leaders have willingly shared power with those who had none, whether they were citizens of territories, former slaves, or disenfranchised women. And we could go on. The reason so many academics miss the real history of America is that they assume that ideas don't matter and that there is no such thing as virtue. They could not be more wrong. When John D. Rockefeller said, "The common man must have kerosene and he must have it cheap," Rockefeller was already a wealthy man with no more to gain. When Grover Cleveland vetoed an insignificant seed corn bill, he knew it would hurt him politically, and that he would only win condemnation from the press and the people. But the Constitution did not permit it, and he refused. Consider the scene more than 200 years ago when President John Adams, just voted out of office by the hated Republicans of Thomas Jefferson, mounted a carriage and left Washington even before the inauguration. There was no armed struggle. Not a musket ball was fired, nor a political opponent hanged. No Federalists marched with guns or knives in the streets. There was no guillotine. And just 4 years before that, in 1796, Adams had taken part in an equally momentous event when he won a razor-thin close election over Jefferson and, because of Senate rules, had to count his own contested ballots. When he came to the contested Georgia ballot, the great Massachusetts revolutionary, the Duke of Braintree, stopped counting. He sat down for a moment to allow Jefferson or his associates to make a challenge, and when he did not, Adams finished the tally, becoming president. Jefferson told confidants that he thought the ballots were indeed in dispute, but he would not wreck the country over a few pieces of paper. As Adams took the oath of office, he thought he heard Washington say, "I am fairly out, and you are fair."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.